For more than 2 months, we have been at war with Germany. But during that time, my memory has often taken me back to the moving statement which the Prime Minister broadcast to the nation on Sunday morning, September the 3rd, a quarter of an hour after we declared war. You will remember his final words. It is the evil things we shall be fighting against. Brute force, bad faith, injustice, oppression, and persecution. And against them, I am certain that the right will prevail. These words were said at a tragic and solemn moment for our country, for France and Poland, and for the whole civilized world. And at the time they were spoken, and since, they have more and more seemed to answer the two questions that, with growing insistence, were likely to present themselves to thoughtful minds. The first of these questions is, what is the real purpose of our struggle? And the second is, may we in fact feel secure that through victory in this conflict of physical force, we can achieve it? What is the real purpose of our struggle? That many people are seeking an answer to this question is evident from the desire expressed in so many quarters that the Allied countries should define with greater precision what are sometimes called war aims. In general terms, the answer has been plainly given. We are fighting in defense of freedom. We are fighting for peace. We are meeting a challenge to our own security and that of others. We are defending the rights of all nations to live their own lives. We are fighting against the substitution of brute force for law as the arbiter between nations, and against the violation of the sanctity of treaties and disregard for the pledged word. We have learnt that there can be no opportunity for Europe to cultivate the arts of peace until Germany is brought to realize that recurrent acts of aggression will not be tolerated. It must accordingly be our resolve and not only to protect the future from the repetition of the same injuries that German aggression has inflicted on Europe in these last few years, but also, so far as we can, to repair the damage successively wrought by Germany upon her weaker neighbors. And that purpose must be the stronger as it is reinforced by knowledge of the cruel persecution of causes and persons at the hands of ruthless men in Germany. In general, it is no business of one nation to interfere with the internal administration of another. And history has plenty of examples of the futility of such attempts. The British are particularly reluctant to interfere in other people's business, provided always that other people do not seek to interfere in theirs. But when the challenge in the sphere of international relations is sharpened, as today in Germany, by the denial to men and women of elementary human rights, that challenge is at once extended to something instinctive and profound in the universal conscience of mankind. We are therefore fighting to maintain the rule of law and the quality of mercy in dealings between man and man, and in the great society of civilized states. We foresaw, indeed, that the time might well come when we should have to fight for these saving graces of our earthly commonwealth. Some months ago, it seems many months ago now, I spoke at a dinner at Chatham House with what I was told was unusual frankness. Among other things, I said this. Over a large part of the world, the old standards of conduct are being set aside. Things are being done which we can hardly read without amazement. Rules of conduct between nations are being overridden with the same callous indifference as rules of conduct between man and man. And I added something that is always to be remembered if we are to pursue this struggle in the spirit that can alone support the price that it is likely to exact. We ourselves must see, I said, that our own standards of conduct do not deteriorate, because the day that we lose our respect for our fellow man, our democracy will have lost something on which its vitality depends. I spoke then at a time when I hoped, as we all did, that somehow or other war might be honorably averted. That hope was disappointed. Faced with evil things, as the Prime Minister truly said we are, there are only two courses open. You must either defy or you must acquiesce. And acquiescence is dishonor. As I look back to those days in which we all walked in the dark valley of decision, I can feel no doubt in my own conscience that only with supreme dishonor could we, in fact, have averted war. And now, a supreme dishonor, as well as the supreme folly, lie with the aggressor. The supreme dishonor of the German government is laid open to the world. We, and those who are fighting side by side with us, men of our race from every quarter of the world, are peoples owning the same loyalty to the crown, our French and Polish allies, we are all united in the will, and under Providence we have the power to prove also the supreme folly with which the German government has moved to its own destruction. That brings me to my second question. May we, in fact, feel secure that through victory in this conflict of physical force, we can achieve our purpose? In other words, after victory, what then? What kind of a better future is it for which we may be content to make sacrifice and not count the cost? The Prime Minister has stated that we seek no vindictive peace, that we have no territorial ambitions for ourselves, and that we should feel the future to hold little hope unless the new peace settlement might be reached through the method of negotiation and agreement. But we are determined, so far as it is humanly possible, to see to it that Europe shall not again be subjected to a repetition of this tragedy. With this purpose in view, we shall use all our influence when the time comes in the building of a new world in which the nations will not permit insane armed rivalry to deny their hopes of fuller life, and future confidence not be forever overborne by grim foreboding of disaster. The new world that we seek will enlist the cooperation of all peoples on a basis of human equality, self-respect, and mutual tolerance. We shall have to think out again many things that lie at the root of international contacts, a social, a political, an economic, and find means of reconciling the necessity of change in a constantly changing world with security against the disturbance of the general peace through resort to violence. To this order that we shall seek to create, all nations will have their contribution to make, and the great responsibility, both in thought and action, will rest upon our people. We, not less than others, have our lesson to learn from past failures and disappointments. We have no idea what the shape of the post-war world will be. We do not know the circumstances in which hostilities will end, or the materials which will lie to our hands in building the edifice of peace. There are some who believe that the new order can only come through surrender in some measure by the nations of their sovereign rights in order to clear the way for some more organic union. But if it is thus hoped to create a more truly international system out of independent states, we must learn the lessons of the past. And no paper plan will endure that does not freely spring from the will of the peoples who alone can give it life. Nor will it avail for one people alone to see a vision that has no message for their neighbors. International, like national institutions, must have deep roots, and if they are to grow, must have, like everything else, a soil that suits them. There is a cynical saying that it is often the task of the wise to repair the harm done by the good. When this war is over, we shall have to see to it that wisdom and goodwill combine for the immense task that will await us. When or how we may be able to feel that our objects have been attained, it is in no man's power to say. But provided we are in fact convinced that both our decision and the general direction of our course are right, we need have no anxiety about the issue. I am confident that if the British people can maintain their own standards of purpose and conduct throughout this war, we shall, with God's will, be the better equipped in spirit to play our part in ordering a better future. For in this matter, as indeed in all life, it is finally the spiritual side that counts. To many, it seems strange that we should look to force, with all its suffering, to bring redemption. It is, of course, profoundly true that the things of the spirit can only finally be conquered in the spiritual sphere, and that physical force is not of itself able to destroy the evil which is the source of war. We need not deny the limitations set to what physical force alone can do, but the recognition of this truth should never blind us to the fact that if, for fear of the tragedy of war measured in human lives broken and destroyed, we rest inert before action which we hold evil, we are surely surrendering to annihilation the expression of spiritual values which have inspired and guided all human progress. Certainly, we are not alone in these beliefs and aspirations. Across the seas, the peoples of the Empire, across the Channel, France, twice our ally in war within a generation, and in all parts of the world, many nations which are not involved in the present conflict, all these have sensed the threat to standards and values that are theirs not less than ours. This road which we intend to travel may be a long one. A great Englishman, Francis Bacon, once spoke of the good hours of the mind. Those hours in which we strengthen ourselves to take high resolutions and to face grave dangers. Between them lie long periods of everyday existence in which the spell of the good hours often fades and life again seems drab and uninspired. The old Christian writers were keen observers of human nature when they placed this sort of paralyzing boredom among the deadly sins. And the way of salvation is just to carry on, which is often the most difficult thing of all to do. The stimulus of great events is not there, and it is not easy to keep in mind the need for doing with all our might what lies ready to our hand. We have time to ponder our own grievances and to reflect on how much better we could do someone else's job. The right to grumble is almost traditional with the British race, who do it supremely well. And it is a mark of freedom as compared with Germany, where grumbling is quite likely to land you in a concentration camp. The impulse to grumble is not wholly bad. It may spring from an honest desire to improve things. It may avert or repair mistakes, and it can bring together different points of view. So let us keep our freedom, but let us use it to the greater strengthening of our purpose. And we must always remember that our enemies will not be slow to make the most of anything that they can represent as evidence of divided purpose and weakening resolution. It is our duty here, just as much as it is the duty of the men on active service, to stand united, firm, unshakable in mind and heart. On this will certainly depend our power to meet the challenge in the present struggle, and when that is over, to answer the call to work worthily for the future of mankind.